Hello everyone, welcome to AVLSL lecture number 28 part 1. Today we are going to analyze the discuss the topic of large signal analysis of differential amplifier, right? Now this is my basic differential amplifier pair or basic differential pair which we have seen before, right? And here we consider the differential output V out, that is V out 1 minus V out 2. Your RD1 and RD2 is equal to RD, and ID1 plus ID2 will be equal to ISS, which is my constant current source. So now our objective over here in this analysis will be to determine Vout1 minus Vout2 as a function of Vin1 minus Vin2. That will give us the differential voltage gain using the large signal analysis method. OK, so it's a mathematical technique, so the steps will go on very, very straightforward. Yeah, so let me begin. So we are assuming that RD1 and RD2 are same as equal to RD, correct? So what will be Vout1? Vout1 will be VDD minus ID1 into RD, and Vout2 will be VDD minus ID2 into RD. Okay, so when we take Vout1 minus Vout2, if you see carefully, it will be VDD minus ID1 RD minus of VDD minus ID2 RD. So if you open the bracket over here, we'll get VDD and VDD will get cancelled out. And what do we left out over here? Vout1 minus Vout2 will be equal to RD into ID1 minus ID2. So we call this equation as 28.10.1. Okay. So next we have to calculate now ID1 and ID2 in terms of Vin1 and Vin2. Because ultimately we have to relate Vin1, Vin2 with respect to Vout1 minus Vout2. Okay, so therefore we will calculate ID1 and ID2 in terms of Vin1 and Vin2. So now let's assume that the circuit which is shown over here is symmetric. Okay, and also assume that the lambda 1 and lambda 2 is equal to 0, and the body effect for both the transistors are ignored, and your M1 and M2 are saturated. So now the voltage at we call this node as node P. So the voltage at node P will be given as follows. So remember VGS1 minus VGS1 will be VG1 minus VS1. So what is VG1 over here? Vin1, right? And VG2 is Vin2. But what is your node voltage over here? What is VS1 and VS2 equal to? VS1 and VS2 will be equal to VP, correct? So over here we write VGS1 is equal to VG1 minus VS1, that is equal to Vin1 minus VP. So now VP voltage can be written as Vin1 minus VGS1. Similarly, VGS2 can be written as VG2 minus VS2, which is nothing but Vin2 minus VP, and VP can be written as Vin2 minus VGS2. Okay, so we have two equations of VP over here. Now from this your VP will be VP will be equal to Vin1 minus VGS1, which will be equal to Vin2 minus VGS2. So we can say clearly that Vin1 minus Vin2 is equal to VGS1 minus VGS2. Okay. Now, for an NMOS device in saturation, your drain current is given by half mu n Cox W over L VGS minus VTS the whole square. Correct. If lambda is 0, this is the formula. Now we want to write VGS minus VTH in terms of other things. So what we will have? VGS minus VTH the whole square will be twice ID divided by mu n Cox W by L. But if we want to write VGS in terms of everything else, we have to take the square root on both the sides. You will get VGS is equal to square root of twice ID divided by mu n Cox W by L plus VTH. So that means VGS value we can substitute with this expression over here, right? So from this 28.10.4, what can we write? We can write Vin1 minus Vin2 is equal to VGS1 minus VGS2. So what is VGS1? Square root of twice ID1 divided by mu n Cox W by L of 1 plus VTH1 minus square root of twice ID2 divided by mu n Cox W by L 2 minus VGS2. Okay, because we have opened the bracket. Now M1 and M2 are symmetric MOSFETs. We are saying they are similar. So VGS, sorry, VTH1 and VTH2 will be equal to VTH. Here you have the same threshold voltage. Also, let us assume that their W by L ratios are also same. I mean, more or less same, correct? So what do we get if the threshold voltage are same? This VTH will cancel with this VTH. And now what do we do is we square both the sides. Okay, so when we square both the sides, what do we get over here? We'll get Vin 1 minus Vin 2 the whole square. Okay, Vin 1 minus Vin 2 the whole square will be this we call it as A and this we call it as B. So it is A minus B the whole square. Okay, here actually W by L, this dash has not come. I will put it, just wait. I hope the screen is visible and it's clearly. Yeah, let me put it over here. Yeah, so let me continue the discussion now. So basically it's A minus B the whole square. We know that what is A minus B the whole square? A square plus B square minus 2AB. So what do? We take A square. So A square, A itself is root of this term. So A square will be twice ID1. Divided by mu n c ox W by L. Similarly, plus B square, it will be twice ID2 mu n c ox into W by L. And minus 2AB. So 2 into square root of this and into square root of this. Okay. Actually, your ID2 will come. Sorry for that. Here, instead of ID1, ID2 will come. Let me change that. Because why it will be... Yeah, here also is the same thing. Let me change this. And let me put ID2 over here. Here it will be ID2. Okay. Similarly, here also it will be ID2. Yeah, now it's proper. So we have expanded just A minus B the whole square. And I mean, if we club the term together, so we will have Vin 1 minus Vin 2 the whole square will be equal to twice. We know that ID1 plus ID2 will be ISS. So here all the terms are common. Twice divided by mu n c ox W by L is the common. And inside the bracket we have ID1 plus ID2, which we can call it as IDSS. Okay, from here also we take this common. Twice divided by mu n c ox W by L. Actually, yeah, we can take this out because it's multiplication. So the result will be, see, square root of mu n c ox W by L into square root of mu n c ox W by L will be mu n c ox W by L. And into square root of twice ID into square root of twice ID2, right? And we have substituted over here, ID1 plus ID2 is equal to IDSS. So in the next step we have Vin 1 minus Vin 2 the whole square will be twice mu n c ox W by L. In the bracket, you will have IDSS minus twice square root of ID1 into ID2. Because over here, square root of 2 into square root of 2 will be 2. Correct? And now what do we do is we take this on this side and we'll take this, isolate the term of ID1 and ID2. So what do we get over here? Half mu n c ox W by L into Vin 1 minus Vin 2 the whole square minus ISS is equal to minus twice square root of ID1, ID2. Now again we square both sides. So when we square both sides, again here we'll have A minus B the whole square. Now in this case, A is this term over here. So it will be, what is A square now? 1 upon 4 mu n c ox W by L the whole square into Vin 1 minus Vin 2 raised to 4. Okay, because we are squaring this. Plus IDSS square. And minus twice AB. So twice into this term, so that will be your 2 and 2 will get cancelled out. You will get ISS into mu n c ox W by L, Vin 1 minus Vin 2 the whole square is equal to 4 times ID1 ID2. Okay, we'll take this square, so this will be 4 times ID1 ID2. And this we call it equation number 28.10.6. Okay, now we know something that we can write 4 times ID1 ID2 can be written as ID1 plus ID2 the whole square minus ID1 minus ID2 the whole square. So if you open this up, if you open this bracket and solve this, you will get it equal to 4 times ID1 ID2. only. Okay. Now from here, what do we get? ID1 plus ID2 is ISS, correct? So we substitute this as ISS square. So 4 times ID1, ID2 is equal to ISS square minus ID1 minus ID2 the whole square. So now ID1 minus ID2 the whole square will be ISS square minus 4 times ID1, ID2. Okay. So what do we do is we substitute this. As you can see over here, we have this term over here, right? 4 times ID1, ID2. We substitute this over here in this expression above. I'm marked in blue color. So now I'm rewriting the expression of 28.10.6. So what do we get? We get over here, you know, ISS term will also come over here, right? So here you will have ID1 minus ID2 the whole square, which will be equal to ISS square. OK, minus this entire term will come. Entire term will come over here as it is from here, above expression. So from here we see that ISS square will get cancelled out and your terms will simplify as follows. ID1 minus ID2 the whole square will be minus 1 divided by 4 into mu and cox W by L the square, the whole square into V in 1 minus V in 2 raised to 4 plus ISS into mu and cox W by L into V in 1 minus V in 2 the whole square. So what will be ID1 minus ID2? You'll have to take the square root of this. So what you will get? You can take this half mu and cox W by L V in 1 minus V in 2 common. Inside the bracket you will get 4 times IDSS mu and cox W by L minus V in 1 minus V in 2 the whole square. So what you do is you can open this bracket. You will get the above expression only. So you have to very carefully craft this expression in such a manner that these are the common terms. Half mu and cox W by L V in 1 minus V in 2 are the common terms. And inside the bracket, if you open it up, you will get the same thing. Okay. So this is a very, very important equation. That's why it's in the box. So we have derived a relation between ID1 and ID2 in terms of V in 1 and V in 2. So this equation, we call it 28.10.8 over here. ID1 minus ID2 is equal to this expression. Okay. Now we'll continue this further. It's a long derivation actually. Anyways, we'll continue this further. So I've written the same expression over here, 28.10.8. And now do we do it analysis? Now we do the analysis on it very, very quickly. Okay. So from this expression, we see that ID1 minus ID2 is an odd function of V in 1 minus V in 2, as you can see very clearly. That means if V in 1 is equal to V in 2, your ID1 minus ID2 will be equal to 0. Also, as your mod of V in 1 minus VD2 increases, your mod of ID1 minus ID2 also increases as well because they are directly proportional, as you can see. So let's say we denote the differential quantities now. So V in 1 minus V in 2 will be denoted by delta V in, and ID1 minus ID2 will be denoted by delta I, delta ID. Okay, so we can rewrite the expression above expression as follows. Delta ID is equal to half mu n cox W by L, instead of V in 1 minus V in 2, we write delta V in, into square root of 4 ISS divided by mu n cox W by L minus delta V in the whole square. Okay, instead of V in 1 minus V in 2 the whole square, we'll write delta V in the whole square. Now what do? We differentiate the above expression with respect to delta V in. Okay, why we do that? We want GM. And what is GM? Capital GM. It is the change in the current divided by the change in the voltage. So the delta ID upon delta V in is nothing but my GM. And once we know GM, we can calculate the gain. So we differentiate this expression 28.10.9 with respect to V in. OK, delta V in. So you will get half mu n cox W by L into one, you know, differentiation of delta V in is one. And then you have this square root term. OK, so inside the bracket, if you solve this, you will get, if you differentiate it carefully, you will get 4 ISS divided by mu and cox into W by L minus twice delta V in square. Okay, and in the denominator, we'll get 4 ISS into mu and cox W by L minus delta V in square raised to half. So I leave the differentiation up to you. How do we get this? I've actually not written one step, so y'all can figure it out how this expression has come. OK, this is a very, very important expression. And now we say that delta ID upon delta Vin is GM, capital GM, is my transconductance of differential amplifier, not an individual MOSFET. Okay. And now if we assume that delta Vin is very, very small. If we assume delta Vin is very, very small, we can write this GM as follows. So GM will be half mu n Cox W by L into one. This delta Vin term is not there over here. Okay. So from here, the following terms will get cancelled out. Mu n Cox will get cancelled. W by L will get cancelled. This two and you here you will get two. So finally, you will get GM expression as twice ISS into square root of mu n Cox W by L divided by square root of 4 times ISS. Okay, so if you solve this further, you will get GM is coming out to be square root of mu n Cox W by L into ISS. Fine. So if you plot the variation of overall transconductance of a differential amplifier, we see over here that whenever delta Vin is almost zero, meaning Vin 1 and Vin 2 value is very, very close to zero, that time I'm getting the transconductance as maximum. Okay, whenever your delta Vin is reaching, some other value that is plus delta Vin 1 or minus delta Vin 1, the value of the transconductance reduces. Okay, so we see over here that for delta Vin equal to zero, your GM is maximum and it is equal to square root of mu n Cox W by L into IDSS. OK, now in the above equation, that is 28.10.8 over here. This is the expression over here, right? 28.10.8. If we substitute Vin 1 minus Vin 2, the whole square is much, much less as compared to 4 ISS divided by mu n Cox W by L. Then what will happen? In this expression, if we assume that this value is much, much less as compared to this, then we can ignore this value. OK, so finally, this expression can be rewritten as follows. So ID1 minus ID2 will be half mu n Cox W by L Vin1 minus Vin2 into square root of 4 VISS divided by mu n Cox W by L. Now we know that your GM expression is nothing but square root of. I mean, from here also it will yield the same GM expression. OK, so your GM expression will be square root of mu n Cox W by L into ISS. Now, this will yield the same expression as before. So how did we get this? How did we get this term? GM is equal to square root of mu n Cox W by L into IDSS. So what do we do is we take this GM. You know what is GM, right? GM will be ID1 minus ID2 divided by Vin1 minus Vin2. So this ID1 minus ID2, Vin 1 minus Vin 2, you take it on the left hand side and solve this. So if after solving this, you will get GM equal to square root of mu n Cox W by L into IDSS. So this will give you the same expression of GM as before. OK, and now we know that from the, from the diagram, from the circuit diagram of your differential amplifier, let me show it to you. Let me take one differential amplifier circuit and paste it over here. So that it's easier to understand. Just for time being, I will delete that later. OK, let me please concentrate over here. So we can say V out 1 minus V out 2 will be equal to RD times ID 1 into ID 2. OK, we have seen this before. This is the expression from 28.10.1. Initially we have arrived at this expression. So here ID1 minus ID2, we can replace it by delta I. Okay, so we can say that your delta I will be equal to GM times into delta Vin. Okay, so now agree or no? Do you agree on this point? Your delta I is nothing but what GM is, what actually delta I upon delta Vin, correct? So now in this case, we can write V out 1 minus V out 2 divided by Vin 1 minus Vin 2 is actually equal to GM into capital GM into RD. And we have already derived the formula for capital GM. It's square root of mu n Cox
W by L into IDSS into RAD. So this is my differential voltage gain of my differential pair. Okay, so your voltage gain of my differential amplifier, differential voltage gain by the large signal analysis is given by the formula square root of mu n C aux W by L into ISS into RAD. Now, the expression of 28.10.10 over here in this case, it will suggest that over here that if GM will be zero, if delta Vin will be equal to square root of twice ISS divided by mu n C aux W by L. So in this expression over here, if delta Vin is equal to square root of twice IS mu n C aux W by L, then we can say that this numerator term will be zero. So if this numerator term is zero, your GM will be zero. Okay, so that's what this tells you. Just a minute, it's getting loaded. Only one last point is remaining. I'll complete that, then we will complete this session. Any doubts so far in this derivation? You have understood how do we got this relation between your V out 1 minus V in 2, V out 1 minus V out 2 divided by V in 1 minus V in 2 is nothing but your GM RD. So only one thing is left, that what will happen for larger values of V in 1 minus V in 2. Okay, so remember all the earlier equations were derived under the assumptions that both M1 and M2 are on. But in reality, what will happen is, if your V in 1 minus V in 2 exceeds a limit, we know that one transistor will be on and other will be off. Correct? And the one transistor which is on, it will take all the current ISS. So turning off the other. Okay, so for example, M1 can take the current IDSS and M2 will be off. It will take the current zero. So denoting this value, we denote this value by delta V in 1 when this happens. When this happens, your ID1 is same as ISS and your delta V in 1 is same as VGS1 minus VTH. That means your M2 is nearly off. Okay, so in this case, my delta V in 1 will be equal to square root of twice IDSS, twice ISS divided by mu n C aux into W by L. So whenever my V delta V in is greater than my delta V in 1, my M2 will be off. Here, over here, if you see carefully, whenever my delta V in is greater than delta V in 1, my one of the transistor will be off. In this case, my M2 will be off, M1 will be on. Okay, and that particular transistor will carry the entire current. Fine with it? Are you all following? So for delta V in equal to 0, what are the observations over here? Now, last point over here. For delta V in equal to 0, GM is maximum. And ID1 and ID2 will be equal to IDSS by 2. GM will be 0 for delta V in equal to delta V in 1 over here, as you can see over here, right? V in will, GM will be 0 whenever delta V in is equal to delta V in 1 and delta V in is equal to minus of delta V in 1. Why we write it minus of delta V in 1? Because V in 1 and V in 2 are basically, we can say that it's just a notation over here. On the left hand side, we write it minus, and on the right hand side, we write it plus delta V in 1. Okay, so these are just the variations of your transconductance, overall transconductance of a DFAM, and variations of the drain current of a differential amplifier versus the input voltage difference. Okay, and whenever your V in 1 is equal to delta V in 1, delta V in 1, your ID1 will be equal to IDSS. Your M1 will be on and your ID2 will be zero. Similarly, for this case, if delta V in is equal to minus of delta V in 1, your M2 will be on and ID2 will be maximum equal to ISS and your ID1 will be zero as M1 is off. Okay, here it is written. Fine. So one last conclusion over here. As you can see, there is a small segment. That is a linear region. I'm marked in blue color over here. So your differential amplifier becomes more linear if you check out this term, delta V in 1 is given by square root of twice ISS divided by mu n C aux into W by L. So your delta V in 1 or delta minus delta V in 1 will be this expression over here, right? So your DFAM will become more linear if my ISS increases, my disk range will increase, or my WBAL decreases. But what happens as WBAL decreases, your delta V in 1 will increase, widening the input range. So if you want a wider input range, your delta V in 1 value will increase. But as your ISS increases, both the input range and the output swing will increase as well, because you know ISS is directly related to your output swing as well as the input range. So if you want to make your differential amplifier more linear, you have to have your current source ISS value higher value, and your W by L ratios, individual aspect ratios of the transistors, should be lower. Okay, so we conclude this analysis over here about the large signal analysis of your differential amplifier. I hope it is clear to y'all how we got these things so far. Any doubts you all have, y'all can ask.